Yo, welcome back to the Gentleman's Game. This is the fourth installment of the Art of Seduction series. If you haven't checked out episodes 1, 2, and 3, check those out here. Today we're going to be talking about the fifth and sixth type of seducers, the natural and the coquette. I consider these two to be more relatable. Most people can tap into their inner natural and coquette pretty easily if they really try to. But first, if you could do me a favor and smash that like button, it really helped me out with the algorithm. Make sure to subscribe and hit the notification bell as well. Okay, so the natural. I want you to think back to the happiest parts of your childhood. Maybe you were in a playground playing tag with your friends or eating an ice cream cone. Remember how simple things were back then? How spontaneous and carefree everyone was with no responsibilities? No one really had an agenda to manipulate you. People were sincere for the most part. Well, that's exactly the feeling that the natural taps into when he's seducing someone. When people are around naturals, they feel at ease because of the playfulness from the natural. The person's defensiveness is immediately neutralized and they're infected with this delight. A guy who knows how to tap into his inner natural understands how desperately most people want to reconnect with their inner child. As Green explains, a child represents a world from which we have forever been exiled. Because adult life is full of boredom and compromise, we harbor an illusion of childhood as a kind of golden age. As children, we had a pleasurable attitude to life. Confronted with a particularly charming child, we often feel wistful. We remember our own golden past, the qualities we have lost and wish we had again, and in the presence of a child, we get a little of that goldenness back. Natural seducers manage to somehow avoid getting certain childish traits drummed out of them by the adult experience. Guys who are successful adults, yet preserve certain childlike qualities, seem remarkably seductive. Now, that's not to say they literally act like children. That would be obnoxious. It's more so the spirit they retained. And it's possible for you to do the same if you can let go and stop being so hesitant. Natural seducers usually have one or more of the following characteristics: having a touch of innocence, acting fearless, being able to improvise and be spontaneous, and staying open and playful rather than being defensive. Robert Greene gives an example of a natural seducer. It's 10th century Japan during the middle of the Cherry Blossom Festival. In a palace, while everyone else was asleep, Oboro Tsukiyo was awake, reciting some poetry in her smooth, delicate voice. She moved over to take a look at the moon. Then all of a sudden, a hand clutched the sleeve of her robe. She was startled. "Who are you?" "There is nothing to be afraid of," said a man's voice. She noticed he had a sweet smell. Then he continued her poem from where she left off. "There is nothing misty about the bond between us." He slowly pulls the princess over to him, picks her up, and moves her outside. She's scared at first, terrified, about to call for help when she finally recognizes this scent. He was Genji, the young son of the late emperor. This calmed her down a bit since she knew who he was, but she also knew his reputation as a relentless seducer who stopped at nothing. She was worried she'd be caught by the watchguard being with Genji, but noticed Genji's face had the most sincere look, almost innocent, with no sense of malice. He started reciting more poetry in his charming voice. The images he was able to conjure up filled her mind, distracting her from his flirtatious touching. Eventually, she couldn't resist him any longer. The next morning, Genji said a few tender words, they exchanged fans, and he quickly left. In the upcoming days, Princess Oboro Tsukiyo could only think of Genji. She knew he had other mistresses, but when she tried to put him out of her mind, a letter from him would arrive, and she'd be back right at square one. She had to see him again. She arranged for future little meetups with him, despite how risky this was, because her sister, Kokiden, the emperor's wife, hated Genji. Eventually, one night, a jealous guy who tried pursuing Oboro Tsukiyo discovered her with Genji and immediately told Kokiden, who was naturally furious. She demanded that Genji be banished from court, and he had no choice but to agree. Genji went far away until things settled down. Eventually, as Green writes, a kind of emptiness had come to the court. The dozens of women that Genji had seduced could no longer endure his absence and flooded him with letters. The young emperor missed his playful presence. Oboro Tsukiyo eventually pined for his midnight visits. Kokiden realized herself that she missed him, and so Genji was summoned back to court. And not only was he forgiven, he was given a hero's welcome. The story of Genji has been written about multiple times in Japanese literature, and each time, he's almost always portrayed as a natural, an indefensible lover, someone who sorta has a lifelong obsession with women, but whose appreciation and affection for them makes him irresistible. When he first meets Oboro Tsukiyo, he straight up tells her that he's going to seduce her. This almost childlike level of self-belief is part of Genji's charm. When she initially resists him, he doesn't get defensive. Instead, he retreats gracefully, reciting some poetry that he knows will stir up her emotions. And as he leaves, the cologne on his robe leaves a sweet scent behind him. Instead of being afraid, his targets end up being curious about him and gives him a chance. You see, Genji didn't take anything too seriously. He was a natural, a playful, mischievous, yet seemingly innocent seducer. Writers would describe how even at 40 years old, an age where most men of the 11th century were already looking old and worn, Genji still seemed like a boy. So in order to tap into your inner natural, you have to realize that most human beings are highly influenced. Their moods are easily spread to the people around them. In fact, I'd even define seduction as a conscious creation of a mood or feeling that's reproduced and reciprocated by the other person. But unfortunately, negative emotions, ones like hesitation and awkwardness, are also contagious and absolutely deadly to an effective seduction. If, when a key moment comes, like for example the moment you're supposed to kiss her or lead her away or gaze into her eyes, and you hesitate, you seem indecisive or self-conscious, then the other person will sense that you're in your head, only thinking of yourself instead of being overwhelmed by their charms. The seductive spell will be broken. The natural seducer, on the other hand, produces the opposite effect. She might be hesitant or worried at first, but after being confronted by someone so sure and natural, she can't help but be caught up in the mood. And you can learn the skill, the same way you can learn to lead a girl across the dance floor. It's all simply a matter of rooting out of your fear, the awkwardness that's been built up over the years, and being more playful and more graceful to your approach, and less defensive when they seem to resist. You see, a lot of the time, a girl will hesitate simply as a way to test you, seeing if you're confident enough to continue pursuing her, or if you'll awkwardly hesitate. If you fail this test, you'll probably end up making her doubt you. So the next seducer we're going to talk about is the coquette. Coquettes are seducers who've basically mastered the art of delaying satisfaction. This is perhaps the greatest art of seduction. While waiting, the target is enthralled, waiting for what happens next. Coquettes tend to be really good at this by alternating between heat and coolness, basically push and pull, to always keep someone guessing. Kinda like a, now you have me, now you don't. They seduce with the potential promise of reward, yet they rarely give it, and this only makes their target pursue them more. Robert Greene writes, "An easy conquest has a lower value than a difficult one. We are only really excited by what is denied to us, by what we cannot possess in full. Your greatest power in seduction is your ability to turn away, to make others come after you, delaying their satisfaction. Most people miscalculate and surrender too soon, worried that the other person will lose interest. However, the opposite of true. Hot and cold, such coquetry is perversely pleasurable, heightening interest. Never be put off by your target's frustration. It is a sure sign of enslavement." An example of a coquette was Andy Warhol, one of the most influential artists of the 20th century. He led a movement known as pop art. As an aspiring artist in 1960s New York City, he was presenting his first one-man show at the Stable Gallery. On the walls were a series of these paintings based on the Campbell's soup can and the Coca-Cola bottle. At the opening and the party afterward, Warhol would stand to the side with this blank stare, talking very little. He was such a contrast to the older generation of artists who were full of energy and aggression, and were big talkers. All the art critics were baffled by Andy's work. It was vague, with a bit of coldness to it. They couldn't figure out how Andy felt about his art, what he was trying to say. And when they would ask, he would reply with something like, "I just do it because I like it," or "because I like soup." These art critics would go crazy with their interpretations of what he meant by this, and the show was a huge success. In 1963, Andy rented a large loft space called The Factory that became a hub for aspiring actors and artists to hang out at. There at night, Andy would be seen simply wandering about or standing in a corner. People would try to gather around him and ask questions, fighting for his attention, but answers would always be vague and non-committal. No one could really get close to him, physically or mentally. He simply wouldn't allow it. Just being around him offered a kind of celebrity to these artists. The Factory became the place to be seen. Famous stars would go to these parties, and they began sending limos to Andy to bring him to their own parties, since Andy's presence alone was enough to turn a social evening into a scene, even though he mostly kept to himself and passed through in near silence. You see, Andy Warhol was an effective coquette because he was elusive. early on in life, he wanted to be famous, but he was passive and shy. At first, he tried to make himself more aggressive, forcing himself to be social and charismatic, but that never worked. So he decided he'd stop trying and just be passive, only to find out how powerful withdrawal was. You could see it in his art, paintings of soup cans and such, whose meaning was totally elusive, which just heightened people's fascination. And he taught himself to not say too much, emanating this coolness that suggested a certain type of confidence. His silence made people want to talk. His appearance of not needing other people just made everyone want to do things for him, hungry for any type of recognition and favor. You see, to tap into your inner coquette, you have to recognize that seduction is a process of drawing people in, of making people want to pursue and possess you. If you put a little bit of distance, people will go crazy trying to win your favor. Humans hate emotional distance. Silence will make them strain to fill up the empty space with words and favors. As Green puts it, stand back and let them fight over you. Coquettes are teases. They intentionally or unintentionally trap people emotionally by giving pleasure, then withdrawing, alternating between hot and cold. You see, the more obviously you pursue someone, the more likely you are to chase them away. It can be endearing for a while, but eventually it becomes claustrophobic and annoying. Coquettes are a master at inspiring excitement, then acting aloof. They're never jealous. That would ruin their image of being self-sufficient. They incite jealousy. A good way to do this is with the wave principle that I talk about in this video. So to summarize today's video, today we talked about the natural and the coquette. The natural is someone who's good at tapping into his inner child, seducing his victims with playfulness and a touch of innocence. The coquette, on the other hand, plays a much more calculating game, selecting when to give and when to remove attention in order to get their target hooked on their validation. That's it for today. Next week, we'll be talking about the seventh type of seducer, the charmer. You don't want to miss that one, so make sure to like, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. And as always, peace.